Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Framed by James Ponti. Narrated by Brian Holden. 1. The Not-So-Safeway. My name's Florian Bates. I'm 12 years old and a 7th grader at Alice Steele Middle School in Washington, D.C. My two favorite foods are pizza and egg rolls. I'm on the student council, I'm in the Scrabble Club, and I plan to try out for soccer. I also work for the FBI. I know, that last one kind of comes out of the blue, doesn't it? Technically, they classify me as a covert asset, which sounds very James Bond spy-like, but only means they want to keep me a secret. After all, it would be pretty embarrassing for them to admit they get help from a 12-year-old. And it would be even worse if one of the guys on the 10 most wanted list showed up at my front door in a bad mood. So the covert part is good for both of us. Becoming a detective wasn't something I meant to do. It just sort of happened because I notice things other people don't. My brain's weird that way. It spots details that seem insignificant and snaps them together like puzzle pieces. The only people outside the bureau who are supposed to know my status are my parents and my best friend Margaret. But that changed the day the Romanian mafia kidnapped me after school. I was taking a shortcut behind the Safeway supermarket, and unless they were trying to influence any upcoming student council votes, it meant my identity was no longer a secret. It's funny because earlier that day Margaret had warned me not to take that route. Normally we walk home together, but on Thursdays she has piano, so I go alone. That's when I look for shortcuts, not because I'm in a hurry, but because it's like another puzzle. "There are a lot of dumpsters back there," she pointed out when I told her about it. "And you know what Ben Franklin said about dumpsters? Nothing good ever happens when you're surrounded by them." I'm pretty sure Ben Franklin was dead about 150 years before the dumpster was invented, I countered. "Then maybe I saw it on a poster. Either way, it's good advice. You shouldn't go back there." "It may smell bad," I said, feeling suddenly defensive, "but it's not like it's dangerous or anything." "Hmm," she replied. "And how do you know that?" I thought about it for a moment and smiled. "Because it's called the Safeway? If it was dangerous, it would be called the Unsafe Way." She didn't find this nearly as clever as I did. So while I laughed, she just shook her head and said, "Boys are so funny." Then she leaned in close and added, "And so stupid." Considering I was kidnapped in the exact place she warned me not to go, I'd say that little nugget belongs on a poster too. In my defense, I was going to walk the long way, but it started raining and I didn't want to get soaked. I'd just squeezed through the gap in the fence and was hurrying behind the store holding my backpack over my head when I noticed the delivery truck. It should have been parked by the loading dock, but I was too busy worrying about getting wet to pay attention to that. The rain was so hard I could see through its windshield only when the wipers swished across the glass. That's why I didn't notice the driver had gotten out and left the engine running. I figured someone was just sitting inside waiting for the storm to pass. When he stepped out from behind a dumpster, I almost crashed into him, which would have hurt because he was enormous. The sign on the truck said it belonged to a flower shop called the Happy Leprechaun, but this guy was neither. He was about 6'4", 300 pounds, and looked like a professional wrestler, one of the villains. He just stared at me, unconcerned about the rain pelting down on his giant bald scalp, and smiled. For a nanosecond, I thought I was letting my imagination run wild. Then I looked down and noticed he wasn't wearing comfortable shoes like a delivery person would. He had on steel-toed work boots popular among factory workers, bricklayers, and international assassins. I sprinted in the opposite direction, digging around in my backpack as I ran. I was trying to find the panic button the FBI had issued me. All I needed to do was push it twice and a team of agents would be put on instant alert. Unfortunately, he got to me before I got to it. He tackled me, and we skidded across the wet pavement into a pile of old fruit cartons. At first, I thought I'd sliced my knee open, but what looked like blood turned out to be rotted strawberries smushed into my jeans. I tried to scramble up onto my feet, but he wrapped his arms around my head and put me in a sleeper hold. Just before I blacked out, I looked at all the dumpsters and told myself that I really should start following Margaret's advice. I don't know how long I was unconscious, but when I woke up, I had a throbbing headache and was lying on the floor of the truck with my feet bound together and my hands tied behind my back. I let out a low, painful moan.
Ugh. Feel better if sleep, he said with a thick accent. 20 minutes.
For a few seconds, my vision was blurry. But when things came into focus, I saw something beautiful, my backpack. He must have picked it up so no one would find it and come looking for me. That meant I still had a chance to press the panic button. I just needed to distract him long enough to scoot over to it. I'd taken a hostage survival course at Quantico, the FBI training center, but at the time I couldn't imagine anyone wanting to kidnap me, so I didn't pay as much attention as I should have. Crazy stupid, I know, but at least I remembered the basics. Survival step 1. Build a rapport with your captor. That was an impressive tackle, I said. Are you a football player?
Football is baby sport, he scoffed. Pads, helmets, I play man sport. Rugby.
Well, I bet you're great at it, I said. Did you play back home in Romania? He looked into the rearview mirror and eyed me suspiciously.
Oh, you know I'm Romanian.
I didn't want to tell him that the FBI had warned me that the Romanians were after me, or that I saw the Romanian flag tattooed on his forearm when he put me in the sleeper hold. I wanted him to like me, so I tried buttering him up. My grandfather is from Romania, I said. I have a picture of him when he was a soldier, and he looks just like you. This made him smile. For the record, my Papa Gio is from Italy, and my Grandpa Ted grew up in New Hampshire, but I think it's okay to lie when you've been abducted. By the way, as one Romanian to another, I continued, I think you've made a mistake. I think you nabbed the wrong kid. The smile turned into a scowl, and I worried that I'd offended him. I'm not saying you're not good at your job, I added. It's just that, with peer pressure and our need to fit in, kids look and dress so much alike that even we have trouble telling each other apart. One time my parents drove right by me at pickup. My own parents. So, there's no shame in grabbing the wrong one.
Not wrong, he replied forcefully.
Survival step 2. Disrupt your captor's train of thought. Do you mean not wrong as in I'm not wrong in what I'm saying, or not wrong as in you're not wrong in whom you kidnapped? I waited for a response, but all I heard was a low, frustrated growl. I assumed this was his deep thinking noise. If you don't use pronouns, it really makes the conversation hard to follow. You need to say you're not wrong or I'm not wrong. Especially in a situation like this, with threats and demands, the wrong pronoun could have someone else ending up with your ransom money. And that wouldn't be good for either one of us.
Not wrong,
he barked again, as if saying it louder suddenly solved the grammar issues. Just then, he swerved to avoid another car, blasted his horn, and yelled what I assumed were choice Romanian curse words. I figured he was distracted enough for me to start inching toward my backpack. Don't feel bad, I continued. I understand how hard it is to learn a new language. My family moves all the time. I've had to learn French and Italian. It's molto difficile. That's Italian for very difficult.
Stop talk.
That's a perfect example of what I mean. You said stop talk, but it should be stop talking. English is so complicated. But let's forget about grammar and get back to you kidnapping the wrong person. Like I said, it's an easy mistake and easy to fix. If you let me go, I promise not to tell anyone. Just drop me off at the nearest metro station.
Shut mouth or else.
The or else was ominous, and combined with the continued lack of pronouns, it reminded me of the third step from my training. Survival step 3. Do not antagonize your captor. When I told Margaret about the steps, she couldn't believe this wasn't first. So far, I'd managed to get about halfway to the backpack, but I still needed one big push to reach it. When my FBI handler warned me about the Romanians, I did some studying and came across a website with phrases in different languages. I'd learned one just in case a moment like this arrived.
Vehiculum meu aeriene plin cumaemute.
I wasn't sure about my pronunciation, but it must have sounded Romanian enough, because moments later, he veered over to the side of the road and slammed on the brakes. The truck came to a screeching halt that sent me tumbling across the floor. At this point, the backpack was just beyond my fingertips. I was about to scoot the last little bit when he stood up, walked into the back of the delivery truck, and leaned over me. No regard for personal space or dental hygiene.
"What saying you?"
he demanded, his face red and splotchy. "I said that if you let me go, I won't tell anyone."
"No," he replied as he leaned even closer. "What saying you, Romanian?"
I gulped and gave it another try, hoping I'd remembered it correctly. One wrong word could give the sentence a totally different meaning. Vehiculul meu aeriene plin cumaimute. Judging by his glower, I was pretty sure I'd ruined everything. I could just imagine the funeral, with my FBI instructor saying I told him not to antagonize his captor, and Margaret shaking her head and responding, "And I told him not to go behind the Safeway." He reached down and pressed his beefy hands against the sides of my head, and I waited for the inevitable crushing of my skull. But that's not what happened. Instead, he flashed a huge, yellow-toothed grin and laughed.
"Hovercraft?"
he asked, mispronouncing the word as he continued to laugh. "Yes," I replied, smiling back and repeating the phrase in English. "My hovercraft is full of monkeys." It was a silly phrase from a silly website, but it seemed to do the trick. Rapport had finally been established.
"You're funny,"
he said as he helped me back into an upright position. "Thanks," I replied. "By the way, you're funny is excellent subject-verb agreement. I wonder if the fact that you were more relaxed helped..."
"Now shut mouth."
"Okay, so it was only limited rapport."
"Oh, and forget about the backpack," he said. "I already took out what you're looking for."
He cackled, and my heart sank.
"No call home for you,"
he added as he pulled my phone out of his shirt pocket and dangled it in the air. I tried not to show relief that he had only found my phone and not the panic button. "Okay," I said, sounding as disappointed as I could. "No call home." 15 minutes later, we pulled off the highway onto a farm road and parked behind a barn. Everything was quiet for a moment until he said,
"Do not joke when here, understand?"
It was more of a warning than an order, as if the next person I met might not have a sense of humor. "I understand," I replied. "Thank you." He untied my feet and led me into the barn, my sneakers squishing down into the mud as we walked.
"Sit here and wait quiet,"
he instructed when we reached an old wooden picnic table. Survival step 4. Brains are better than muscles. I knew I was about to come face to face with Nicolae Navrescu, a ruthless gangster known as Nick the Knife. He was the prime suspect in the case I was working on, and considering his reputation, I figured I was running out of time to act. The more I thought about my situation, the more upset it made me, and the more upset I got, the harder it was to breathe. At first, my breaths were slow and labored, but then I started to gasp for air.
"Quiet,"
the kidnapper told me. My gasping intensified, and I leaned forward against the table in full panic mode.
"What is wrong?"
he said. I was trying to figure out how to hyperventilate and talk at the same time when a new voice came to my rescue.
"He needs his inhaler. Inhalator," he said, using the Romanian word.
I looked up from the table and saw that it was Navrescu.
"Yes,"
I wheezed as I nodded.
"Where is it?"
asked the kidnapper.
Back,
I gasped.
"Get it now," said Navrescu. "We can't let him die, at least not yet."
The massive man rushed back to the truck and grabbed my backpack. Since my hands were still tied behind my back, he just dumped everything onto the table and I pointed at the inhaler with my head.
"Squeeze," I gasped.
He held it up to my mouth and pressed down while I sucked in a lungful of mist.
again, I said, my voice returning to somewhat normal. He squeezed a second time, and I sucked down some more mist. You've got to hand it to the FBI. It looked and worked just like an actual inhaler. You'd never guess it was really a panic button. Thank you, I said with a huge sigh of relief. You just saved my life. Help was on the way. Now I only had to drag things out until it arrived. Navrescu sat down across the table from me and started to look through the papers strewn across the table. I don't know what ruthless crime lords are supposed to look like, but he looked more businesslike than I expected. His hair was cut stylishly, short on the sides but a little thicker on top. He had a neatly trimmed beard and mustache and intense blue eyes. He also spoke with an accent, but his English was perfect. Florian Bates, he said, reading my name off the top of some homework. You are the one the FBI only talks about in whispers, the one they call Little Sherlock. I have no idea what you're talking about, I said. He gave me a disappointed look. Let's not play games. I know who you are, and you know who I am. I nodded reluctantly. I know you're the man who masterminded the robbery at the National Gallery of Art. He chuckled. Mastermind? I love that word. I wish it were true. No, that fact you have wrong. That's why I had you brought here. So we could set the record straight, and you could tell your friends at the FBI they are looking for the wrong person. He started to roll up his sleeves, and I could see the collection of tattoos on his forearms. One was a red and black eel that I recognized as the symbol of the Eastern European League, a crime syndicate known as Eel. There were other assorted tough guy phrases and symbols, but one of them didn't fit in with the others. It was a daisy with the numbers 24/7 directly beneath it. It looked like the logo of a flower shop willing to make deliveries 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. But Navrescu didn't exactly seem like a florist. He saw that I was staring at it. What's wrong, little Sherlock? Young Sherlock, I corrected. What's that? They don't call me little Sherlock. They call me young Sherlock. He laughed. I thought you had no idea what I was talking about. I gave him a look. I thought we weren't playing games. Okay. So what's wrong, young Sherlock? I'm not sure, but it's right there, I said, trying to make sense of it. I can almost see it. I closed my eyes and tried to picture the puzzle pieces. Daisy, 24/7, Eel, FBI, Nick the Knife, Romania, Happy Leprechaun, Safeway. It just didn't make sense. And then, snap. I opened my eyes and smiled. The solution seemed completely impossible except for one detail. It was the only thing that made the pieces fit together. There's been a huge mistake, I said urgently. You need to let me go right now. Is that so? He laughed. Why should I do that? I looked right at him and did not blink. Because the FBI is going to be here in less than 5 minutes, and that doesn't leave us much time to talk about why your tattoo changes everything. 2. The meaning of toast. 3 months earlier. I promise I'll explain how Nick the Knife's tattoo changed everything. But before I can do that, I have to explain what everything is. That means I have to go back 3 months earlier to when I first came to Washington. Back then, I wasn't a covert anything, just a kid whose family moved a lot. And I wasn't looking for a criminal mastermind. I was trying to find my underwear. Mom! I yelled down the stairs. I can't find my boxers! You'd think that after 4 moves in 7 years, I'd be better at packing and unpacking my stuff. But after dumping 3 boxes of clothes onto my bed, I'd found plenty of sweaters, jackets, and gloves, very helpful considering it was the middle of summer, but no underwear, unless you count an old pair of tighty-whities that were 2 sizes too small. It had reached the point where I'd had to put on a bathing suit after my shower. Mom! I tried again. There was still no response, so I went looking for her. I was halfway down the stairs as I called out, Do you know where my boxers... My words trailed off when I saw that she was at the front door talking to a girl. The last thing I wanted to do was discuss my underwear in front of some random girl, so I tried to make a save. "Boxes," I said with a fake cough, trying to cover the change. "Do you know where my boxes are?" Judging by the girl's smile, I had fooled exactly zero people. "Florian, I'd like you to meet one of our new neighbors," Mom said. "This is Margaret." The first thing that stood out about Margaret wasn't that she's African-American or even that she's about 3 inches taller than me. It was that smile. Bright white teeth with silver braces across the bottom row. There was something so easy and friendly about it. I've always wanted a smile like that. In pictures, mine just looks like I'm scared of some creature lurking behind the camera. But hers radiated confidence. "Welcome to the neighborhood," she said, holding up a plate of cookies. "Thanks," I answered. "I was just looking for my boxes," she said. "Right, boxes." There was an awkward silence until my mom came to the rescue.
"Why don't I find them while you two have some cookies?" she suggested. "In the kitchen, where there's less mess."
Margaret and I snaked our way through the unpacked chaos of the front room into the kitchen. "Milk?" I offered.
"Yes, please."
Rather than sit down at the table, she poked around the piles of stuff stacked on the counter, more curious than snooping.
"So where'd you move from?"
"Rome," I said. She looked up.
"The one in Italy?"
"Is there another?" I asked. "I think there's one in Georgia," she said. "It definitely wasn't Georgia," I replied. "It had the Colosseum and lots of Italian people riding around on scooters."
"Is that where you always lived?"
"No. But before that, we were in Boston, London, and Paris," I said. "We move a lot. My parents work in museums."
"That sounds cool. Mine are just lawyers,"
she replied as she plopped down at the kitchen table.
"The boring kind, not the murder trial kind. By the way, I love this house."
"Thanks," I said as I handed her a glass of milk. "I think yours is great, too. My mom's insanely jealous of the flowers in your front yard." The instant I saw her reaction, I realized my mistake and wished I could rewind the conversation and try it again. "You know where I live?" I stared at my cookie for a moment before nodding. "Four doors down and across the street. The yellow house with the brick chimney and a piano next to the big window in the front room." She tilted her head to the side and asked,
"How did you know that?"
I could have just told her that I saw her in her yard or something, but I didn't want to start with a lie, so I told her the truth. "Well, I saw the house, and just now I saw you, and I could tell that you live there."
"You could? Do I look like I live in a yellow house? Like I have a chimney and a piano?"
"Of course not," I replied. "It's just that I went for a walk this morning, and..."
"You saw me then?"
she asked. "No, I'm pretty sure you were asleep."
"What time was it?"
she asked. 5.
"I was definitely asleep. Do you normally go for walks that early?"
"Not normally, but we just got here a couple days ago and my body still thinks it's on Italy time. I woke up and couldn't fall back asleep, so I figured it would be a good opportunity to get to know the neighbors." She laughed.
"And how many neighbors do you meet at 5 in the morning?"
"None," I replied. "But I don't really need to meet them in order to get to know them. You can tell a lot about someone just by what you see from the sidewalk."
"And you were able to tell that the yellow house with the brick chimney and the piano is mine?"
I nodded.
"How?"
Past experience had taught me that people are turned off by this particular skill, but I was too far along to stop now. "There's a girl's bicycle in the side yard," I explained. "The seat is set for someone tall like you."
"Just because there's a girl's bike, that doesn't mean..."
"I'm not done," I said, cutting her off. "You're wearing a University of Michigan t-shirt, and there is a University of Michigan Law School decal in the window of the silver station wagon in the driveway. There's also a DC Dynamo sticker on the bumper, and an identical one on the bumper of the green sedan parked on the street."
"So?"
"Your soccer shorts," I said, pointing to them. "It says DCD right there on your shorts. I'm guessing you play for the Dynamo?" She took another bite of her cookie as she thought through it all.
"Anything else?"
"Well, judging by the way you dip your cookie in your milk, I'd say you're left-handed. But that's about it." She sat there for a moment, with her mouth slightly open.
"That's amazing, she finally said. I don't know if it's super freaky amazing or unbelievably cool amazing, but it's definitely amazing. Usually people think it's just strange and they never talk to me again, I said. But it would be great if you think it's cool, because from what I saw, only two other houses in the neighborhood have kids and they're way too young. You're my best bet for a friend. Is that so? She said. And did you do this with all the houses in the neighborhood? I nodded. She had a spark of an idea, and I could see the wheels turning as she leaned forward and asked, Which house belongs to the insane person who screams at you if you so much as put one toe in her front yard? Easy, I replied. Three doors to the left, blue house with the crazy perfect hedges. Who puts up way too many Christmas decorations? Gray house across the street from you. She gave me a look. How could you possibly? You can see the nails along the roof line where they hang the lights, I explained. Okay, let me come up with something you can't figure out from the street. She flashed an evil smile. Where would you find a ridiculously large comic book collection? I toyed with her for a moment to let her think she'd stumped me. Then I answered, The greenhouse on the corner with the double security bars on the basement windows and the Fantastic Four license plate holder on the car. At this point, even I thought I was weird, but she just smiled and shook her head. I want that, she said. I want that! The comic book collection or the license plate holder? No, that skill, she said. Can you teach me how to do that? It had never dawned on me that this was something I could actually share with someone else. You want me to teach you toast? Toast, she asked. You've tasted my cookies, which are epic. Don't you think I know how to make toast? Not that toast, I said. Toast stands for the theory of all small things. That's how I read people and places. The idea is that if you add up a bunch of little details, it reveals the larger truth. And where did you learn this theory? Philosophy class? Spy school? Invented it, I guess. This made her laugh. You invented toast? It's based on some things I learned from my parents, I said, but I put it all together and came up with the name. So, yes, I invented it. You said your parents work at museums, right? My father designs security systems, and one day he explained that the key to his job is finding the tiny flaw or inconsistency that the bad guys can take advantage of. Like the saying that a chain is only as strong as its weakest link. Exactly, I said. And my mother's an art conservator. She restores old paintings and says the best way to understand a painting is by finding the smallest detail that tells the whole story, like the smile on the Mona Lisa. And this led to toast. I nodded. Even though their jobs are incredibly different, they both rely on the idea that tiny things can be hugely important. I explained. Once I even used toast to help my dad catch a criminal. This I have to hear, she said as she grabbed another cookie and chomped happily. How'd you do that? There was a museum in Spain that was robbed 3 times in a year. The stolen items were small but extremely valuable. No one could figure out how the thief was doing it. They hired my dad and he checked everything out and was just as stumped as they were. But one day, he had a bunch of reports spread out on the kitchen table, and I started looking at them. Most of it was technical stuff that I didn't understand, but I noticed all the robberies had 2 traits in common. What? She asked eagerly. They all happened on Saturdays when it was raining. Margaret considered this for a moment. And you were able to figure it out from Saturday and rain? No, I said. I just noticed it. My dad was the one who figured it out. You see, museum attendance usually doubles on the weekend. That makes sense. And with that many people, when it was raining, the coat room didn't have enough space for all of the raincoats. They had to open an additional room to handle the extras. When they did that, they shut off part of the alarm system to keep it from sounding all day. That's brilliant, she said. Dad's pretty smart, I replied. And you'll teach me this? Sure, I said, but it will have to be some other time. Why? Because I think you have to go somewhere right now. What time is it? She asked, suddenly panicked. I've got to get to soccer practice. She got up to go and then stopped in her tracks and looked back at me. How did you know that? She demanded. Did you just toast me again?
I laughed. It's not a verb, but no, I didn't toast you. I can see the driveway through the side window, and your car just got here. My guess is that the woman headed to the front door is your mother? Just then, the doorbell rang.
See you later,
Margaret said as she rushed out of the room. When she reached the front door, she turned back and added,
By the way, in case you're wondering whether I think it's cool or freaky,
I took a nervous breath. She flashed the smile and said,
Very, very cool.
3. Napoleon's Candle. There are some things, like breathing and walking, that you do automatically. And since you don't really think about them, they're hard to teach. For example, how would you teach somebody to breathe? Would you make up a list of step-by-step instructions? 1. Suck air through nose. 2. Blow air back through nose. 3. Repeat 20,000 times every day. That might work, but it's kind of cheating because suck air and blow air are just two other ways of saying breathe. You haven't actually explained how to do it. You've just swapped the words. Toast is like that for me. It's more instinct than idea. So when Margaret asked me to teach her, I wasn't sure how to break it down into something that made sense. I took her to the National Gallery of Art, the museum where my mom works, and showed her a painting of a man with red hair and a beard. Margaret, I'd like to introduce you to Vincent van Gogh, I said. Hey, Vince, how's it going? She replied, playing along. And then she turned and asked, Why do you want me to meet him? Because he's the artist I know best, I told her. Mom's crazy about him, so she's taught me a lot. Like, for instance, he only painted about 10 years, but still created more than 2,000 works of art. That's pretty amazing. And he usually couldn't afford to hire models, which is why he painted so many self-portraits like this one. I love the colors. The orange beard, the blue background, the little flecks of green in his face. Margaret studied the picture. It's very cool. But he looks kind of sad. I think he was sad a lot of the time, I said. Is that why he cut off his ear? She asked. How'd you know about that? Everybody knows Van Gogh cut off his ear, she said. It's common knowledge. I guess it is, I said. But here's the.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.